We'll go slightly out of sync with what's been going on in the HSS class. What I plan to do this morning is to split up into groups of six. We'll do towards the end of the class, right? What we'll do is review some public speaking tips. And after we've given you those tips and hopefully some sheets, do we have copies of those sheets? Okay, fine. We'll give it to you next time, but we'll cover it in the class. Some simple public speaking tips, after which I want to spend 20 minutes recording the people who have not been recorded yet. And then we want to break you up into groups of six and get the process started, which will take us till the end of semester. Okay, and what we'll do is that each week in class we'll be working with smaller groups. I think you have to turn that down. We'll be working with smaller groups, so we'll have the class divided up into two parts. So. Okay, so after midsem we'll have you divided into smaller groups, and we'll have half the class on Tuesday and half the class on Thursday, with the belief that a lot of the work is going on outside class, right? Planning and discussions and reading and stuff like that. There's this whole issue of this PPNP grade which is at the end, and this PP grade will only be given to all those who've got 80% attendance here and they've actually taken part in the group activity. That means we want them to stand here at the end of the semester and do their presentation. There's going to be a 5 to 6 minute TED talk that you guys will work towards, and we are hoping that each person of the group will have a chance to say their say, if you like, in that presentation. So it's up to you how you want to structure everything, right? So in the process of doing this TED talk, it's, if you like, a kind of a seminar, a mini seminar if you like, and it also prepares you for everything else that you have to do at the end of the semester, right? And we hope it's going to be very helpful. Now, an interesting exercise, the proofreading that you guys did in the last class, right? We proofread those documents ourselves, right? We proofread all those documents ourselves, and we found that if you guys have found about 660 errors, if we total it, we found about 1100 errors. So we found twice as many errors as you folks have discovered. Now, why is this exercise useful? To make you a bit more humble about accepting the fact that the documents that you write do need some work, right? And what should be submitted as a seminar report or an MTP report should not be your first draft. You should get your friends to read it, because it's typical, it is very typical for us also, right? When we write anything, somebody else will find much more errors than I will, because I've made the mistakes, how do I know I've made it, right? Or what happens typically, quite normally, is that you write something, there are some mistakes, but you are not looking for mistakes when you read the script, you are looking for logical strands and stuff like that, so you don't notice these mistakes after some time, right? And in fact, you'll notice also, if you have to move house, you must have moved hostel rooms and stuff like that, there's some prize, the possession that you kept in the corner of your room, right, which you omit taking with you when you move house or move room, because it's been there for so long that it looks like part of the room that you don't even think that, you know. So that's what happens if you see something often enough, you don't notice it, okay? So, do make sure that whenever you write anything, somebody else also reads it, because you might have lots of assumptions in your mind that you don't realize, right? And it will help if somebody else points out things about your writing to you, okay? Yeah. So, I've got them as slides. Okay. So, Prakash helped us prepare the public speaking notes. So I'll talk for a bit and then he should come and give his pitch. So in the TED talk, let me just introduce you to what we have in mind, right? You guys are going to change the world, okay? You must believe that. Otherwise, there's no point being here and wasting your time, okay? So given that, think of some ideas around, say, a nation building theme, some kind of social innovation, some kind of technology innovation. You all must be having some ambition of, say, starting a company or starting an enterprise or doing something, helping something, right? Or whatever you have. And think of the audience that you want to pitch it to. The audience could be some angel investors. They could be some venture capitalists. They could be some benevolent industrialists who wants to fund these kind of things, Bill Gates or whoever it is, right? Or it might be just an MHRD project, like we're doing projects for NME ICT, which is National Mission for Education Using ICT, right? And the way we got the money is that we had a dream, right? And we went to them and said that, look, here's our dream and here are the numbers to do with this dream and this is what we promised to deliver in 2 years' time. That's how the projects started. And we just gave them our proposal and got the funds and there's huge bandwagons going here. Right, Professor Phatak's projects, Professor Modgalia, our e-yantra project and stuff like that. There's a lot of things going on, okay. So decide what you want to achieve and decide who you want to pitch it to and start doing the research, right. We want you to do some research and not just speak off the top of your hat. Even if you got some wild way out ideas which are entertaining and stuff like that, do some research to make us believe that what you're saying might actually work. Okay, and you can be as wild as you want, right? It's not an issue, okay? And part of all this will be your presentation skills. So like in a TED talk, you'll have a presentation, you'll be standing up here and speaking and you'll be cueing yourself whichever way you want. So what we'll do is that after the mid-sem, we'll start giving you doses of the kind of equipment that you need to be able to build an effective presentation, like say one class on body language, one class on visual communication, right? How to structure a presentation, how to present it, how to use the colors and fonts and stuff like that. People are not sensitized enough to those kind of things, okay? And the audience, if you like, will be enacted by you folks too. So we'll be forming you into groups also, which will act as the evaluating audience, if you like. You could be, say, a bunch of babus in MHRD. You could be, say, an industrialist who's going to sponsor the project. You're going to be, say, a bunch of politicians who are going to review the proposal which has been put by. So we don't know what to expect from you folks. We hope that you'll bring some passion to it. So whatever you feel strongly about, we are willing to listen to that, right? So this will have to be decided in your groups of six, okay? And we'll also be as faculty, we'll also be a part of this entire process, right? So let me get this now discussion. There was a feedback that many of you would like to speak more effectively in front of an audience, right? So we've done some research and Professor Vaidya has come up with a sheet which he won't give you this time. He's being coy about it. He'll give it to you next time, right? So we'll give you this material in handouts and we'll put it up on Moodle also, right? Okay. So public speaking comes naturally to only very few people, right? Typically, it is something that you learn over a period of time. Nobody is a great communicator at the very beginning. It helps for you to take part in school activities like, say, debating and poetry reading and elocution and stuff like that. But if you've not done that, then you can learn some points with which you can actually speak in public effectively, right? And a lot of these are very common sense things. You'll see it all around you in speakers, amongst your faculty who are speaking to you and stuff like that, okay? And you have things like, you need to practice in front of your friends, in front of small gatherings and stuff like that. And there's this whole notion of stage fright and anxiety which you get. And there are techniques with which to overcome that, right? You have this fear of failure, right? You have sweaty palms and stuff like that. It's perfectly natural, right? Which over a period of time, as you practice it enough, just it doesn't happen anymore, right? Then you can talk to an audience as though it's one to one. It's just a question of practice over a period of time. So you just need to do it more. And one of the important things that happens on the course is through your seminars and your MTP presentations and your presentations in the lab and stuff like that, you get prepared for all this, right? One of the reasons, incidentally, I put my daughter for learning classical dance is because they learn to face an audience. Because while you're a kid and growing up, you learn to face an audience and articulate your thoughts and talk to them and not feel intimidated, right? So hopefully later on, it'll be much easier for her, right? Plus they learn grace and learn to use their body and, you know, all that kind of stuff. So I feel all these things are useful and they do help as you go along. Okay. Many people feel that the audience is very critical of them, is scrutinizing them, waiting for them to make mistakes and stuff like that, right? And it's a very natural impression when you stand here to feel that. But actually, it's not like that. The audience wants a nice talk and they want you to speak nicely and they want everything to go well. They're actually helping you. They want you to do well. So don't belittle yourself and feel that what I'm saying has no value and stuff like that, because that's not the case. And that's why we like to initially help you in this kind of environment where in a small group, we'll break the class up into half. In smaller groups, we'll work because it's not a hostile environment, right? And it helps in a small group, friendly group, to be sort of brought out and overcome this inconfidence and stuff like that. And the important thing, you should hear this TED talk, which a few people have summarized on body language. Who's the one who did that body language talk? Yeah, very interesting, very interesting. Body language, right? It's quite interesting. They say that your body language reflects your state of mind. That means if you're frightful, nervous, afraid, you become small, right? And you cross your legs and cross your arms and stuff like that. How many of you are doing that right now? Okay. But if you're confident, you kind of uncross and you're open, things like that. And if you're even more confident, you're like this, right? You talk with hands like this and so on. So you'll notice how dancers are trained to kind of move their hands out and stuff like that and cover a lot of space, okay? So the more expansive you are, the more confident you look and you appear. And more important than that, when you start doing this, you feel more confident. And the signal that you're sending is a confident one, with the result that people treat you with respect and you become even more confident. It's quite interesting that reality is not something that is out there which you're a victim of. You know, this is quite a deep insight I had about 5 years ago. Reality is not something out there and you're a victim of it. Reality is actually like a movie that you're actually projecting on the world out there. Right? You're projecting reality. If I want to believe that you're bad, I start thinking that you're bad. You might not be bad. I start thinking that you are bad, then my behavior will become as though you are bad. And as a result, you will react to that, right? And you will behave in a way that, see, I told you he is bad, right? And then it kind of just reinforces itself, right? Similarly, if I want to believe that you are good, I'll start believing that you are good. And even if you are a little bit bad, when I behave nicely to you, you'll also behave nicely. I say, see, he's a good man, good, right? Similarly, in an audience, the audience is not here to screw you, basically. The audience is here to help you. And if you treat them in that way, you'll feel less afraid. Okay. So just keep these things in mind. And it's quite normal to be nervous. And as Prakash dug out this very nice quote, I showed it to my wife this morning, who's a doctor, and she found it really cute. And she often gives the presentations. She's a radiologist. Butterflies in the stomach is normal. They should fly in formation. Right? It's okay to be a bit nervous because that's what makes your mind a bit more focused and alert. Right? But it should be in order. Right? And your engagement with an audience is like an energy burst which needs to be kind of projected in the right way. And to overcome these kind of this kind of nervousness that you get, right? It's useful to have group discussions and have this kind of environment where you are actually presenting more and more to people. Some people say sing, or some people say practice with a small and friendly audience, and so on. And so maybe Prakash would like to present this bit. He'll read from a script, but you have everything here also. So what we'll do is that for the next, say, 10 minutes, we'll continue this, and then for the next 15 minutes, we'd like to have more of the recordings. In the recordings, we invite you to respond to this these notes. So take note of this and use this in your presentation. So we want to see over a period of time whether these kind of things have made a difference, right? And by the way, your proofreadings which you've done, we put it into an Excel spreadsheet, the scores, and we've also are computing number of errors per word count in the documents. We'll do this exercise again at the end of the course, and we hope that there will be a shift in the error distribution. That means you'll find more errors, or maybe you'll make less errors. Okay, so that's the intention. So would you like to?
Thank you, Kavi, and welcome everybody. So the first thing which we saw in this, that the stumbling block for public speaking is stage fright, which all of you have experienced. Some of you might be still having it. So in surveys it has been found that if you ask people to list their phobias or their fears, and you take a statistics out of that, that what is it that people fear? Like some people fear spiders, some people fear height, some people fear water, and of course many people fear death. So it might be thought that most people will be fearing death, but that is not true, because we take death for granted. Statistically, most people have stage fright. It is their number one fear. So we are not alone if we have stage fright. Even accomplished speakers have butterflies in their stomach. They learn to overcome them, and once you get in charge of that energy burst which is there, then it works for you, and you can project it on the audience. In the Roman times, when the Romans were not Christians, they used to persecute Christians. So they had charged one Christian father, and he was punished to fight with a lion. So you would know what the consequence would be. So he was brought into the ring, the lion was brought, and before the fight started, the father uttered something in the ear of the lion. So the lion thought for a bit, then went back to its cage. So they brought another lion. The father again talked into his ear something. That lion also went away. So after three lions went back, the emperor said, I am pardoning you, but you tell me, what did you tell the lions? So he said, I just told the lions that you will be expected to speak a few words after dinner. And the lions were frightened of that. So you can imagine that stage fright is with everybody. So once we have overcome that, for our speech we have to first prepare a speech. Speech is not only what you deliver, but there is a background work which you have to prepare, just like you have to prepare for writing. So once you know that you are going to give a speech, you start as early as possible. As soon as you are intimated that you will have to give a speech for this much time on this topic, you start early, start jotting down what you would like to speak. Don't wait till the last moment. And at least three things you list out for your speech: that how you will begin your speech, what will be the main core of the speech, and how you will end it. So while writing, you should write down the rough script, and this script should not be like spoken language, because public speaking is somewhere in between formal writing and ordinary conversation. So your language should be such that it should not be too heavy. It should not have compound sentences, complex sentences, but it should not be conversational. It should be slightly more formal than conversational, and you will have to write it out. First you might write out as ordinary speech, but then you formalize the language, and so that it appears dignified. Then suppose you have written out the script like a drama script, don't read it out. This is a mistake many people do. They stuff their PowerPoint slides with lot of lines. You must have seen in many presentations. And then they start reading out. Now what happens is, silent reading, that is without vocalizing, is much faster than reading it aloud with voice. So you are reading it aloud from your slides, while the audience is reading silently, and audience will be ahead of you. So it will have reached the end of the PowerPoint slide while you are in the third line. And after that the audience stops attending. So you are still reading and the audience is not attentive. So even if you have PowerPoint slides, they should be only summary type. They should not be whole script written down and presented one after another. And as far as possible, don't repeat what is said on the slide. You say something else, like you tell an anecdote which you don't put on the slide, then the audience will pay attention. So even if you write everything out, don't present it to the audience. You present only a summary of that and you expand it on that. Then the next thing is, don't memorize your speech. In school elocution competitions, they are given a written script and the children memorize everything, including how they will move their hands, etc. And people think that that is public speaking. But that doesn't apply to adults, because that is mugged up speech, and adults cannot mug up speeches because we are thinkers. Children really don't know the content of what they are speaking, but we are aware of the content. And we cannot do this. Unless you are acting in a drama or something, you cannot memorize your speech. So what happens if you memorize? Dale Carnegie, in his book on public speaking, has given an anecdote that there was a conference of insurance agents in New York, and the star performers were being given rewards and they were supposed to speak. So one such insurance agent, he had prepared his speech, including how he will move his hands, etc., and written down everything and memorized everything. So he came to the stage and started that, "In my part of the project I did," and he blanked out. There is a risk of memorizing that if you lose track anywhere, you can't catch it again, because you have not memorized with concepts. You have just memorized as like a sound file. So he stopped, he took two steps back, again started, "In my part of the project I did," again he blanked out. Again he took two steps back. Before he did it the third time, we should realize that it was an open stage and it had no back wall. So the third time he said this and backed out, he fell down and vanished. So people started laughing uncontrollably and they thought this was all planned, though it was not planned. So this is what can happen if you memorize your speech. So don't memorize the speech. After you have written down the speech and finalized it, reduce it to an abstract, and you take the abstract and expand that when you actually give the speech. Then whatever is your speech, you reduce it to key points which should not be too many. Ideal is to have one page, like you must have seen in all my classes, that everything can be reduced to one page. Everything that is in this lecture is in this one page, and we will be putting a version of this on the net also. These slides are also based on this one page. So you reduce it to one page, then unlike I am doing just now, you cannot read out like this. So what you do is you take postcard size cardboards which are called 4 inch by 6 inch or about A6 size, like pocket diary of this size, because this you can hold in your hand like this and hold at arm's length, that is without people without this obstructing people's view of you. You can hold it like this and read. So on this you write your points in very large font and with good spacing, that from a distance you can read your points. So you write out your this one page, maybe it will make 10 cards like this. So put it on 10 cards and write on one side only because otherwise you won't know which side you are reading. Write on one side only and number the cards so that you don't go in a wrong sequence. And you carry these cards with you, and then as soon as the card is over, you keep it aside so that it otherwise it will come like a deck of cards, the same card might come again, you discard it. So this is the way you can, you won't lose track while giving a speech. Even if momentarily you forget something, the next cue will tell you that what is your next point. So these cue cards have to be short. They should not be full speech written out on a deck of cards, and they should not be so short that there are only 3 points on that. There should be about 8 to 10 cards with say 4 to 5 lines that will cover a normal speech. Then when you have studied and prepared your material, you don't exhaust all your material in your write-up or in your notes. You keep something in reserve, because in speech you are supposed to be on the offensive and the audience will try to corner you. So when they ask questions or ask for clarifications, you can't say this is all I had to say and I have told you everything. Then you will be exposed. You should keep some things in reserve, and when somebody asks for a clarification, then only you disclose that. Then they will get a feeling that you have more things up your sleeve and this is not everything that you had. So don't disclose everything in your speech. You keep something for question and answers. Then after you have prepared your speech, you arrive early. Early means how early? If you are going to a new place and you are unfamiliar with the place, then you should go the previous evening, because previous evening there will be no event there probably, and you will be able to survey the hall or whatever is the venue. So you find out everything, where are the exits, where are the entrances, how is the rostrum, etc., what is the sound system or what are the visual aids, and vet the equipment, means check everything out. Just before the event, if you start checking, then people get disturbed. So vet the equipment, and if possible you set it up the previous evening if the hall is under your control, and leave it with those settings so that in the morning when you come, as soon as you switch on, everything is in order. In the morning you don't come and start searching for cables and connecting. So vet the equipment, and before the actual lecture you come earlier when the audience has started arriving, and at that time the hall won't be crowded. So you enter the hall, not on the dais, and mingle with the audience and try to get introduced to some people, etc., try to get some people's names, because when you start your lecture, during that you can mention that, by the way, I met so and so, etc. So people will think that you are familiar with the audience, you are not an external stick-on speaker. So you should connect with the audience, and people whom you have met, when you are actually speaking, you can identify their faces, otherwise other faces you can't identify. So while making eye contact, you can select those people, because you at least know few people in the audience which otherwise you won't know. So you mingle with the audience and somebody will normally introduce you. So the master of ceremonies has to introduce many people and he can't know everybody. So he expects that the person being introduced will provide a short data about himself. So this you provide yourself, that what you want to be told about you, and whatever the introducer has told, you don't repeat in your speech. If you talk about yourself in your speech, you talk something else. Otherwise they will make out that you had only given these lines to the introducer and he didn't really know you. As soon as, suppose there are many speakers and they are normally sitting either on the dais or in front. Once your name is announced, you will have to get up and go there, etc. So you might think that as when you actually start speaking in the mic, then your time starts. That's not true. As soon as your name is announced, you are on stage. Even if physically you are not on stage, the audience is thinking that you are on stage. So from that point onwards, your behavior should be such that it should impress people. So for example, some people are in such a hurry, like in a prize distribution, etc. As soon as their name is announced, they start running. In a prize distribution, maybe there are 100 prizes, so you have to run. But in a speaking assignments, you don't have to rush. You walk slowly and confidently. And if you act confidently, you will feel confident. If you act diffidently, you will feel diffident. It is self-fulfilling prophecy. So you should act confident when you are going on stage. Then to overcome stage fright or whatever tension you get, you have to practice relaxation. There are three simple exercises given here. Each has to be done 3 times. So these exercises, you don't come on the stage and then do the exercises, otherwise it will be ridiculous. That's why you take time for walking from your seat to the dais. So while you start walking, you do these exercises. So by the time you are on stage, you have already relaxed. So the first exercise is you clench your fists and hold them for 3 to 5 seconds and then release. If you do this 3 times, your body will get relaxed, your tense muscles will get relaxed. Similarly, you take deep breath, that is you take full breath and then exhale slowly. So if you do this 3 times, then also you will relax. Third thing is count 3. So count 3 not as 1, 2, 3, but 1, 1000, 2, 2000, 3, 3000. You count so slowly. You count this 3 times in your mind and you get set for speaking. So this, while you are walking from your seat to the dais, you should do these exercises and you are ready physically. Next, when you are on stage also, don't immediately take up the mic and start speaking. So you buy some time, because audience expect that there will be some introductory. The audience also has to get familiarized with your face and your manner, which takes time. If you start speaking immediately, they don't have time for this. So you can buy time for adjusting the mic, drinking water if available, and arranging your papers or arranging your setup with laptop, etc. This for the audience to get time to get familiarized with you and for you to relax. Next is during the actual speech. Now you don't talk to the front wall or talk to the front desk, but you talk to the audience, and the audience will know this only if you make eye contact with the audience. So for that, you have already got introduced to some people. So you look at them and look for five seconds as if you are talking to that person. Then you look at another person as if you are talking to that person. So the audience will get a feeling that you are actually covering the whole audience and you want everybody to listen to you. So you pan your head over the audience so that everybody, you see everybody, you can get feedback also, that is whether people are uneasy, and the audience also gets a feeling that the speaker is paying attention to you. Then start slowly. because it's like starting a car in first gear or something. That audience also has to start listening slowly. So you start slowly and with a low pitch. If you start in a high pitch, audience will get bored in no time. If you start in a low pitch, that also helps for relaxation, and that also puts the audience in a relaxed mood. If you talk in a high pitch, audience becomes tense. And use abdominal voice, means don't talk from the top breath. If you take deep breath and use that, then you don't have to take many pauses while you speak. Otherwise, if you are using shallow breathing, then every now and then you will be breathing and people can make out the breath sound also. So use abdominal voice, and normally if you inhale well, the abdominal voice is good enough for a whole sentence, by which time there is a full stop and you can take a breath. Within a sentence, you shouldn't have to wait for breathing. Then speed of public speaking. In normal conversation, we tend to speak very fast, like even on a telephone. If you are listening to somebody talking on the mobile and you are hearing only one side, then you get fed up that how somebody can talk so fast. You are not hearing the other side also. In fact, here also you are hearing only one side because you are not talking back. So compared to conversational speed, the speed of a formal speech should be slower, because the audience has a variation in their understanding. All people are not smart enough. Some people have slow understanding, and unless you cover them, you won't cover the whole audience. So while it might sound slow to yourself that you are speaking too slowly, it is the right speed for the audience, because audience expects slow speech. It doesn't know what you are going to speak. You know it because you have written it, you have practiced it, so you think you can deliver it fast, but the audience is not aware of what you are going to speak. So you speak slowly, and whatever sounds slow for you is right speed for the audience. Then while giving a public speech, you should give attention to your articulation and pronunciation. Articulation is production of individual sounds like k and g, which can get confused because they are phonetically similar. That is articulation, that is individual sounds. And pronunciation is full words where you have articulation of many syllables taken together so that they sound together. So both articulation and pronunciation have to be more explicit compared to normal speech. Normally you can get away with slurred speech also, the opposite person will make out in conversation. In a speech they can't make out. If you speak indistinctly, people will find it difficult to understand. So you speak slowly and explicitly, and compared to normal conversation, which can be monotonous, here you should use stress and intonation, because that is what gives information to the audience. Like we saw about commas, that commas are there so that it helps people understand what you have written. Here commas are replaced by short gaps in speech. In addition, on words, you can use stress and intonation to stress important words, which you can't do in writing. In writing, you don't really highlight so many words. And this is especially when you are giving speech to an unknown audience, that don't finish your speech and say, now I'll take question and answer. Because by that time, many people don't have any questions and they want to walk out. So normally you reserve your last point, and before that you say, I'll take questions. So then audience still doesn't know what to expect. The speech is still going on. So you answer the questions and then deliver your last point. Now the last point today is finish in time. If you delay your speech, then everybody gets delayed because there may be many speeches. But if you finish early, everybody will thank you. There was a speaker who couldn't keep time, and he was going on, and at the end he said that, I apologize, but I don't have a watch. Somebody said from the audience, you don't have a watch, but there is a calendar on the wall. Okay. So now I'll take questions. So, if you have any questions, you can put them. Otherwise, regarding gestures, in drama it is said that you can mug up your part, and when you have perfected that, you find that you have one extra pair of hands, because actors don't know what to do with their hands. You suddenly find that you don't know what to do with your hands. The same thing happens with speaking, that some people keep them at the back, some people keep like this, etc. But if you keep your hands like this, then it seems that you are a closed person, that you are not open to new ideas. While if your body is open, then people feel that you are an open-minded person. So you should move your hands naturally, means you don't read up a book and say that for this you move it this way, etc. And don't keep the arm stiff and move only your hands, but move your whole hand right from the shoulder. Then you appear bigger. And you appear more natural. Secondly, while speaking, you tend to make mistakes. Like even I have made mistakes while talking just now, I have realized. But unless the mistakes are serious and likely to lead to misunderstanding, don't correct them. Like even in singing, that is a rule. That if you make a mistake in playing or singing, don't play that phrase again. Then people who had not understood the mistake will also understand the mistake. You play it again. While if you have made a mistake, you just go over it and continue. Many people won't have noticed. So don't, audience expects speakers to make mistakes, and you are just one of the speakers. So even if you make mistakes in natural speaking, people will take it for granted. Yeah, I'll just give one clarification, which that we have tabulated your submissions and who corrected it and how many errors were found. The errors he mentioned, that is say 600, this is regarding only 50 distinct submissions. We took 50 submissions which each has a different topic, because some of them are repeats. We had total 75 submissions which were corrected, but the remaining 25 were duplicates. So those we have not corrected so far. So these are 50 distinct subjects. So the 600 errors is total of all 50 found by the local proofreaders. That comes to average about 12 errors per submission. And the 1000 which we have found, 1050, are additional errors. This doesn't include the first 600 errors. In addition to 600 errors, there are 1050 extra errors, that is about 20 per submission. So now you can make out that what is the gap remaining after one or two checkings.
Is it a two-page document?
Yeah, in a, and which is not your own composition. You have just heard the talk and you have transcribed it. So all the ideas are, even the sentence formation is directly from the speech. So that indicates that we have to practice and improve.